We see it all the time from Hollywood. Whether it's The Day After Tomorrow, The 100, or Mad Max, eventually some big event will happen, and humanity will be pushed to the verge of extinction. As trees take back the city streets, and wildlife starts to thrive, I always notice one thing. No lights ever work. Okay, this isn't all that surprising. The day after the apocalypse, not even Homer would show up to a shift at the power plant to keep the lights on. But still, lots of lights are powered by renewable energy that don't need people. And what about all those emergency lights that are supposed to stay on during power outages? All this got me wondering, if all of humanity suddenly just disappeared, like if Thanos snapped his fingers or something, how long until humanity's last man-made light finally went out? Well, most lights would go out really fast. The original light bulbs developed by Thomas Jefferson couldn't even last a month. With a century of innovation and progress, modern filament bulbs could last a year or two, and LED lights could last up to 2 decades. But these lights need power, and that would go away almost overnight. Even with the push for renewable energies in recent years, fossil fuel still supply the vast majority of the world's electricity. Without people, there would be less demand for power, but our thermostats, traffic lights, and alarm clocks would still be running, sucking up power from the grid. Without people bringing in more fossil fuels to run power plants, some would start shutting down within the first few hours, forcing other plants to pick up the slack. As more and more power plants run out of fuel, more and more stress is put on the dwindling plants that remain. Even when people are around, this can be a really difficult problem to handle. Back in 2012, when Hurricane Sandy slammed against the eastern seaboard, 115-mile-an-hour winds knocked down power lines, and flooding took out 7 substations throughout the northeast. The increased load, combined with the flooding, literally caused the substation on East 14th Street in Manhattan to explode, plunging 250,000 Manhattanites into darkness. As some substations went down, the increasing strain on the rest kept causing more to fail. This resulted in rolling blackouts across 17 states that left more than 6 million people without power. Without fossil fuels flowing into these plants, the same thing would happen, and rolling blackouts would leave the world without power within a few days, and with it, most of the lights across the globe would go dark. Now you might be thinking about all the world's renewable energies. After all, more than a quarter of the world's electrical needs are met by renewable sources. Even without people, wind turbines could still spin, and nuclear reactors could still... well, do whatever it is they do. Well, not so fast. The Svartsengi geothermal plant in Iceland produces just over 1% of the country's power, enough to power 110,000 homes simultaneously. Geothermal plants use the Earth's internal energy to heat water and run it through a turbine. While the Earth will continue to radiate heat from its core for billions of years, the gearboxes and electrical motors won't last nearly that long. They need regular maintenance about every 6 months, and without this, they'd succumb to corrosion within just a few years. Most renewable energy sources that we could use to power man-made light suffer from this same problem. Wind turbines and dams also use motors to convert wind and water into the electricity that goes on to power our lights. Wind turbines would at least outlast the rest. The Svartsengi geothermal plant only needs 12 turbines to produce enough electricity for those 110,000 homes, but you'd need 250 wind turbines to produce the same amount of power. Because of the sheer number of turbines you need to generate any meaningful amount of power, and how difficult they can be to do maintenance on, modern wind turbines are typically rated to run for 3 years between regularly scheduled maintenance. With nearly 500,000 wind turbines across the globe, some basic statistics tell us that at least some should be able to run for decades, providing enough electricity to keep a few lights on. And before you say it, battery-powered lights wouldn't last any longer. Even if the light only turned on for a moment once a year and used very little power, batteries gradually self-discharge over time. Some last longer than others, but even the longest lasting would be dead within a decade or two. What about the king of renewable energy? The power source that should be able to last for millions of years, nuclear power. Nuclear reactors, if they settle into a low power mode, could seemingly run forever. That's because, while typical energy sources don't have that much useful energy stuffed within them, uranium packs a crazy punch. Natural uranium needs to be refined and processed before it can be used in a nuclear reactor. After processing, you end up with a nuclear fuel rod. From there, 18 sets of fuel rods make a bundle, and 2 bundles make a fuel assembly. A typical nuclear reactor holds about 150 fuel assemblies, meaning a reactor with all new fuel could provide about 6.6 billion kilowatt hours of energy. Now I know everyone that watches my videos are some of the smartest people on Earth, But just to give you an idea of how much energy that is, if you could access all of it at once, instead of over the 6-year lifetime of the fuel rods, that would be enough to power the entire US electrical grid for 2 days. That energy could power one of our light bulbs for more than 250,000 years. Besides the fact we already know no light bulb is lasting that long, there's something else that holds back these reactors, and it's those pesky safety engineers. Unfortunately, although there's enough fuel, reactors wouldn't keep running for long. As soon as anything goes wrong, cores are designed to automatically shut down. Without humans to keep a close eye on the reactor, this would happen pretty quickly. A whole bunch of things could trigger it, but the most likely culprit would be a loss of external power. It might seem strange that a power plant would require external power to run, but every part of a nuclear reactor's control system is designed with plenty of redundancies. Imagine if the wires carrying electricity away from the reactor failed, and you needed to shut it down. Well, obviously you couldn't use the reactor to power the shutdown sequence, so instead you'd use external power. But if it was the external power that failed, you could use the reactor's power to shut itself down. That way, even if one power source fails, you'd always have some way to keep the reactor from going critical. This all means that nuclear power plants would actually be the first renewable energy sources to shut down. But reactors on Earth aren't the only nuclear-powered tools. The rest just don't last that long either. A handful of deep space probes use nuclear power. The Mars Curiosity rover is powered by an RTG, a radioisotope thermoelectric generator, and it produces enough power to keep an LED on for centuries. But while Curiosity does have lights, they're only used when illuminating samples and conducting scans, both things that require human commands. So with all humans vanishing from the face of the Earth, no one would be there to turn on these lights. Some other space probes, like the Galileo probe that explored Jupiter in the 1990s, had onboard LEDs, but Galileo was deliberately crashed into Jupiter back in 2003, so that won't be setting any records either. A lot of satellites closer to home carry lights too. Some satellites use LEDs to control charge buildup on their equipment, and they're powered by solar panels that, in theory, could keep running as long as the sun is shining. Unfortunately, they won't last that long. In space, no one can hear you scream, but that's not because there's nothing up there. There's still gas particles floating around, just very few of them. Atmospheric pressure at 350 kilometers above Earth's surface, known as low Earth orbit, and home to about 2/3 of all satellites, and even the space station, is a few micropascals, or about a billion times less than that at sea level. The space station has lights, and so do a lot of these satellites, but the problem is, these orbits aren't very stable. As satellites hit these infrequent gas particles, they slow down just a little bit. And as they slow down, their orbits become lower, so they hit more particles, and slow down even more. And so on, until they burn up in the atmosphere. The average low Earth orbit satellite has a shelf life of only 5 years. The ISS, which costs more than $150 billion to construct, loses up to 0.1 miles per hour of velocity and 330 feet of altitude every day. And so, every month, the ISS has to briefly fire its thrusters to regain that lost altitude. After a few years, the satellites would run out of fuel to fight gravity, and them and their lights would come crashing back down to Earth. Satellites in geosynchronous orbit, those are the ones really high up, about 35,000 kilometers above the Earth's surface, are a lot more stable. But even these orbits don't last forever, because of competing gravitational pulls with the Moon, Sun, and nearby planets, so they too would fall back to Earth within a few decades. Ironically, one of the longest serving lights might be one of the most commonplace. Emergency call boxes, often found along the side of the road in remote locations, are frequently solar powered. They usually have lights on them, which provide illumination at night. Like wind turbines, they're hard to service, and so they're usually built to last a long time. As long as they're kept free of dust and debris, solar panels will generally last as long as the electronics that are connected to them. Solar panels' wires and circuits will eventually succumb to corrosion, but solar panels in a dry place with well-built electronics could continue providing power for a century, assuming they're kept free of dust by occasional breezes. If we follow a strict definition of what light is, these solar-powered lights in remote locations could conceivably be the last surviving human light source. But there's another contender for the crown, and it's a weird one. Radioactivity isn't usually visible, at least not to humans. Watch dials used to be coated in radium, which made them glow. But this glow didn't come from the radioactivity itself. It came from the phosphorescent paint on top of the radium, which glowed when it was irradiated. Over the years, the paint would break down, so they'd stop glowing. But the watches would still be radioactive. Those watch dials aren't the only radioactive light source. When radioactive particles travel through materials like water or glass, they can emit light through a sort of optical sonic boom. This is called Cherenkov radiation, and it's seen in the distinctive blue glow of nuclear reactor cores. Just a side note, this blue light is actually traveling faster than the speed of light, which is possible because it's traveling through a medium like water. Because it's traveling faster than the speed of light, it has a sort of optical sonic boom, which is what creates that blue light you're seeing. Some of our radioactive waste products, like cesium-137, are melted and mixed with glass, then covered in metal shielding so they can be safely transported and stored. In the dark, these glass blocks glow blue. Cesium-137 has a shelf life of 30 years, which means that 2 centuries later, they'll still be glowing with 1% of their original radioactivity. Since the color of a light depends only on the decay energy and not the amount of radiation, it will fade in brightness over time, but keep that same blue color. And with that, we have our answer. Centuries from now, deep in concrete vaults, the light from our most toxic waste will still be shining. I guess mankind's legacy really will be toxic. If you like this video, be sure to check out our best uploads here. And remember, there is always more to learn.